Park Row Books and Harper Audio present Real Friends Talk About Race, Bridging the Gaps Through Uncomfortable Conversations by Iza P. Mukantabana and Hannah Summerhill. Read by the authors. I dedicate my words to all my Black, Brown, and people of color who may find solace in this book. To all people who want genuine, loving, and compassionate friendship, because it's a power we have been neglecting while in thrive of a better future.
For Dave.
Introduction. What do you think of when you hear the word friendship? For me, friendship is something that evolves and grows as we grow and evolve as people. At its best, it supports and guides us, and at its worst, it can be toxic and can take from you emotionally and mentally. Just like intimate relationships, friendships need boundaries and constant care to flourish. They're a reciprocal union that should be genuine, kind, and compassionate. I also wholeheartedly believe that friendships can and should sometimes break if they do not respect and nurture a safe and healthy environment. Friendships don't have to be perfect. They never are. But they need to have a healthy basis to work from, and both sides need to want the best for the other person. In any close relationship, we come to it with our own issues, our self-esteem and past wounds caused by other people in our lives. But I've found that the ideal friendship offers a safe space to try to be the best human we can be in this world, in times of strength and also in moments when we feel the most vulnerable. I personally have had the blessing of curating an amazing group of remarkably close and loving friends. Most of them are friendships that I've had for 10 to 20 years. I really pride myself on how long they have lasted and how healthy they are. I grew up moving around a lot, and a great fear of mine was that I'd become a person that didn't have old friends. People I could laugh with about the ridiculous things we did in our 20s. I had to adapt and learn how to stay in touch, nurture these friendships virtually and on the phone because I wasn't always with my friends in person. Now that my friend group has scattered all around the globe, in Africa, Europe, and the Middle East, I get invited all over the world to gather and celebrate with these special people. I also now make it a point to hold space for new friendships, like my friendship with Hannah. She and I met at an odd time for me, when I wasn't planning on adding more people to my friend group. When we met, I did not instinctively think we would be friends. She had recently started to do anti-racist work, and I appreciated her efforts to be an ally. I also appreciated that she didn't make me feel like I had to be the Black girl that would guide her on her allyship journey. That's a lot of pressure to put on a new friendship, and I was grateful Hannah didn't put me in that position.
As a white person, is there anything more uncomfortable than talking about race and racism, even with your closest friends? Sex, religion, and politics all seem easier than the conversations about race we should be having. Even though most of us want to be seen as our full selves in close relationships, which includes all that makes up our identities, we avoid having productive conversations on race. Unfortunately, our society, our schools, churches, and workplaces have ill-prepared us for these dialogues, the kinds that could lead to real progress. As white people, we avoid them because they're difficult, uncomfortable, and because acknowledging our differences only scratches the surface of what lies beneath even our most benign cross-racial interactions. Our harmful history, our society's obsession with whiteness, and our individual responsibility. For those who are looking to broach the race conversation with their friends, but don't feel equipped with the tools, context, or confidence to do so, we aim to give you those resources with this book. Our goal is to transform the ways that people of color and white people relate to and understand each other, because there is no justice or equity without conversation first. In both interracial friendships and same-race friendships, there should be space to talk about race. I mean that for white friendships too. As white people, we are not raceless, and our silence about racism contributes to an inequitable society, whether it's intentional or not. After creating space for these kinds of dialogues in our work as the Kinswomen, we've seen firsthand how deeply healing and bonding having these conversations can be. The vulnerability it takes to share and be witnessed in all that makes up our identities creates stronger, more fulfilling friendships across our differences, even though they may require extra care and consideration.
Honesty is such a big part of my friendship with Hannah, and I hope that our transparency will give space for conversations that often don't come naturally, specifically within interracial friendships. I've seen firsthand when my Black or POC friends, people of color, realize that they've never had these conversations with their white friends. And by the time they're having them, they realize there's a big gap in understanding. For me, it's like an elephant in the room if these conversations don't come up with my white friends. It's like I'm not acknowledging a huge part of me that makes me whole. I also know from being friends with white people that there are situations that come up, comments, attitudes, and the like, that remind me we're not living in the same type of reality. I think having these kinds of conversations should be a natural, common practice of friendships. I think the biggest reason why it's so hard to talk about race in friendships, even really strong friendships, is fear. The fear that our differences will be too great and talking about race will kill the good vibes. It's natural to be afraid to talk about something that you worry will distance you from someone you love so much. It is scary because there are no real tools that account for the complexity of being friends or in love with someone who says something problematic or has racist ideas. I have felt a great deal of shame when I found myself in those dynamics. I felt responsible, like I had failed myself by putting myself in spaces and interactions that ended up being offensive and damaging both mentally and emotionally. There's always the potential of losing a friend or experiencing the anguish of white fragility, a response that tends to shift blame and cause even more harm. The reality is that interracial friendships are layered and require a different kind of emotional labor. I want to be clear that I never want to pressure BIPOC, Black, Indigenous, and people of color, into having interracial friendships or make it seem that they're required to do the work to teach their white friends about racism. I understand all too well the anguish and hurt that these cross-racial interactions can cause, and I want to honor that. I understand that as people of color, we don't all have the same bandwidth or desire to learn how to navigate this. There are moments when I want to tap out and just take refuge in spaces where I feel seen and understood completely, without having to teach to anyone. That to me is okay too, and it is necessary. Another challenge to having these conversations is that some people think that because friendships form cross-racial lines, it's a testament that racism is dying. While that would be nice to believe, proximity in the form of friendships or romantic relationships to BIPOC does not prove white people are allies or that we've transcended a racist society. The kind of conversations we're hoping to foster also pushes white people to be accountable for the harm they cause, even if unintentional, and to make real changes in their lives. It forces people to take applicable action to make a real shift in themselves. Done well, I think these conversations would make friends and lovers feel closer and allow for a more genuine kinship. I feel safer knowing that I can talk about these issues with my white friends because they're able to see me in my whole experience of this world. I can be open and tell them when I have experienced something hard outside of our friendship, knowing I'll have their support.
Izu and I are always aware of the racial power dynamics that exist in our friendship, and we're conscious of how our partnership is perceived. Our conversations and our work together as a Black woman and white woman reveal the tension, trauma, and discomfort that are often present between white people and people of color. This tension and its fissures are obvious everywhere, on social media, in pop culture, and our knowledge of and perception of history. All of this to say, interracial friendships and relationships are not necessarily easy, nor are they an indicator of a post-racial society. How did Izu and I get here in the first place? We met a few years ago at an event about bridging the gaps between women of color and white women, where attendees were free to approach the mic and share their perspective or personal experience. I sat in the back quietly, but when Izu got up to the mic, she pointed out, exasperated, the lack of participation from white women like me who'd attended an event that was explicitly about cross-racial dialogue. I realized I'd completely missed the point. I was acting as a voyeur instead of being vulnerable. When I saw Izu again several days later, I recognized her instantly. She's striking. Tall, beautiful, and a little intimidating. A true Scorpio, as I'd later come to realize. Hard shell, but soft on the inside. But I introduced myself anyway and asked if she wanted to continue the conversation. I wouldn't be quiet this time. Izu agreed.
I did agree. I usually have Tupac's quote ringing in my head when something unexpected happens. Don't trust nobody. But this time, I let my gut decide, and I shooed off the thought. If anything, continuing the race conversation with Hannah would be a social experiment, and I'd have a good story to tell my friends. But Hannah had good energy and huge eyelashes that clapped together every time she blinked. I thought she looked like Bambi, so I said yes. I was skeptically optimistic. I had no idea what our podcast, Kinswomen, would become, but I was inspired by the conversations we were having and felt the need to bring these untold narratives to a bigger audience. I wanted to help create a space where other women of color like me could safely talk about the racism we experience in everyday situations and feel heard by the white women in our lives. So often, anti-racism work is centered on white people, and I think it's essential for BIPOC to have a space to talk about our experiences and understand our own legacy and its effects. To be honest, I knew nothing about podcasts at the time, but a friend of a friend offered to produce it, and I was excited by the opportunity. When Hannah and I first created Kinswomen, it felt like we were meeting our real selves for the first time. We had a good and healthy rapport early on, even though I knew little about her. As we continue to grow in our business, we are also caring for our friendship, one I believe in and cherish. As in all friendships, there are ups and downs, and we've had our share of both.
We wanted to spotlight this, but we also wanted to create a welcoming space, one that shows compassion to the friends and listeners choosing to engage in these complex conversations. Our platform and podcast, Kinswomen, is aimed at building trust between women of color and white women, and for white women specifically, accepting the discomfort and pain that comes with growth. When we create space to articulate what is often unsaid, or what we believe to be shameful or taboo about race, we can move through this world with more empathy and a better impact on those around us. The cross-racial conversations I've been privileged to be a part of have changed me and my friendships. I want the same for you, no matter how you identify. In this book, we'll share a framework for building trust across racial lines. We'll talk about the covert and overt ways that racism shows up in our interpersonal relationships. And for white readers, how to take radical responsibility for our impact.
Recently, my friend Leslie offered an analogy about hardships in general, which resonated with me in thinking about my friendship with Hannah. Hashem, God in Hebrew, talks about the crushing of olives as the materialization of hardship.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.